Well, thank you. So great to be on Trinity's campus, and I just can't help but reflect on the many, many connections between Wheaton College and Trinity Evangelical Divinity School. I already see some people I know from Wheaton's campus that are studying here. We benefit greatly from faculty and staff that have studied at Trinity and from board members that are serving at Trinity and are also helping us think about Christ-centered education at Wheaton College. And probably if you poke around a little bit on the faculty and staff here, you'll find a few people that were educated at Wheaton. So we're glad for that connection. And what a privilege to come and speak with you this week about preaching and more specifically, preaching from the Old Testament. So there's this experience I have pretty often when I'm preaching, and maybe you've, or when I'm listening to preaching, and maybe you've had the same experience as well. You're into the biblical text, you're hearing what is being said from that biblical text, and you get so excited and so gripped by some truth in that scripture, maybe something the preacher is actually saying or talking about, but maybe not. Not necessarily. It may be that you're just studying that passage and thinking about it, and something really grips you, and you get very excited about the possibility of teaching and preaching that passage for yourself and going deeper into the truths that you're grasping from God's Word. I had that experience one time that was memorable for me in 1 Samuel 22. You might turn there in your Bible as we begin. And the context here in 1 Samuel 22 is that David has been under duress. He has been brought before the king of Gath, which is one of the Philistine cities, and afraid for his life, he has feigned madness, and it's pretty effective, actually. The king says, it's one of the, I think, one of the funnier verses in the Bible, Achish says to his servants, this is chapter 21, verse 14, "Behold, you see the man is mad. Why then have you brought him to me? Do I lack madmen that you have brought this fellow to behave as a madman in my presence?" In other words, I have enough crazy people right here with all the people in my cabinet. I don't know why I need another crazy person here. And so he sends David away. And then you have this remarkable scene in chapter 22 where David goes to the cave of Adullam. And this is the verse that so gripped me. "His brothers and all his fathers heard it. They went down there to him." So his own family members were gathered to him there, recognizing perhaps God's anointing on him. "And everyone who is in distress, and everyone who is in debt, and everyone who is bitter in soul gathered to him, and he became captain over them. And there were with him about 400 men." And as I heard this scripture and thought about this scripture, I could see King David there with people gathering to him as their great leader and king. Not the mighty people, but the broken people. The people who were in financial debt, in straitened financial circumstances. People who were bitter in soul because the things in life that had gone against them, the griefs that they had suffered, the people who were in distress of one kind or another, those were the people that were gathered to David as king. And as I pictured David there, it wasn't just David that I was seeing, but also great David's greater son. Because these are the reasons people come to Jesus Christ and his kingship. It's not the people that have life together. It's not the mighty ones. It's not the people that don't need a Savior. It's people that are weighed down by the debt of sin, by the burdens and griefs of life, by the distresses and bitternesses of the soul. They are the ones who gather to Jesus Christ. And I thought, as I thought of this passage, I thought of Psalm 110 and the prophecies that are made of King David there and of David's son. And in that passage, it's the dew of his youth that are gathered to him, that are clustered around him. And there's a prophecy there about the warriors of David going with him in battle. As I reflected more deeply on this passage, I thought ahead to another experience that David had at the cave of Adullam. It's in 2 Samuel chapter 23, and it's a time when David is under duress and the city of Jerusalem is surrounded and he's driven out of his own territory. And he makes an idle remark, the kind of remark that people are far from home, who are far from home might make. And he said, "Oh, I wish I could have a drink from the well at Bethlehem. Would love to taste that sweet water again." But for David's warriors, these men who had been in distress and broken and in debt, but had now become, by David's leadership, mighty warriors, what the king's wish was their command. And so they traveled into enemy territory, and they secretly penetrated the defenses and were able to draw some water from the well at Bethlehem and bring it back to David. David saw what they had done for him. He was deeply humbled. He couldn't even drink that water. He poured it out as an offering to the Lord. And as you trace the trajectory of these people who had been really transformed by David's leadership, you see a beautiful picture of what happens to us in the gospel. And this was one of those times when the Old Testament and a story from the Old Testament gripped me in a way that compelled me to see my own salvation in a fresh way, and also motivated me to have opportunities to communicate those gospel truths to others. Now, I've given my remarks this morning the rather ambitious title, At Least 31 Reasons to Preach the Old Testament. Did it say at least 31? It's really at least 31. We'll see if we get to 31. Now, I say it's ambitious, and partly because in my early years at 10th Presbyterian Church, I was serving on the platform, leading worship one day at our Thanksgiving Day services, and my colleague and eventually, I guess, became my predecessor, James Montgomery Boyce, was preaching the Thanksgiving Day service, preaching a psalm of thanksgiving, and he did what ended up being a 27-point sermon. It was kind of three sets of 9 points, and he was just enjoying getting into the text and finding all these truths about Thanksgiving. But as he turned back and sat down after the closing prayer, he said to me, "That was too many points, wasn't it?" Now, when you're serving as a new pastor with a renowned leader who's been preaching for 25 years, and they invite you to make any critical comment about their preaching, I mean, you're very careful how you respond. I said, "Well, they were all good points." I think Mrs. Boyce had a little bit more direct comment for Dr. Boyce after that Thanksgiving Day sermon, but don't get all caught up in the individual points necessarily. I simply want to encourage you, refresh you, maybe even inspire you with the help of the Holy Spirit to make the communication of God's Word in the Scriptures of the Old Testament foundational to whatever you do in life and in ministry. Because I believe these Scriptures, as well as the New Testament Scriptures, are an amazing treasure for the life of the believer and the life of the church. And perhaps even being reminded of all the reasons, or at least some of all the reasons, why the Old Testament is so significant for gospel ministry today, may be an encouragement to you to make that foundational to your own life and ministry. It's not so much 30 things that I want to communicate to you. It's really one thing, and I'm going to do it maybe 31 different ways. Here's the first. The Old Testament is the Word of God. The Old Testament is the Word of God. This is confirmed for us many places, perhaps none more familiar than 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. All Scripture is breathed out by God, and therefore, and we'll come to this later, profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, training in righteousness. The Old Testament also is Holy Scripture, and we see that elsewhere in Paul's writings to Timothy back in chapter 1, or in the first letter of Timothy, chapter 5, verse 17. In one verse, the apostle seems to quote both Deuteronomy 25 and Luke 10, and to quote both of those equally as Holy Scripture. And of course, here in 2 Timothy chapter 3, when Paul refers to all Scripture, he perhaps has most clearly in mind the Scriptures of the Old Testament. Not that it doesn't also apply to the New Testament, but clearly the Old Testament Scriptures, that is at the forefront of Paul's mind, the whole Scripture. We believe as Reformation Protestants not only in sola scriptura, that the Scripture alone is our only ultimate authority for faith and practice, but also in tota scriptura. It's the whole Bible that has this role for the Christian life. The Old Testament is the Word of God. Second, the Old Testament is necessary background for understanding the New Testament. The Old Testament is necessary background for understanding the New Testament. Fully 40%, or two-fifths, of the verses in the New Testament either serve as quotations directly from the Old Testament, simply repeating the very words of the Old Testament, or they allude to material from the Old Testament. You can hardly understand the New Testament at all, given the amount of Old Testament that we find in the New, without understanding that Old Testament background. The Old Testament is the backstory to the New Testament. If you believe in the proclamation of the gospel, in the gospels themselves, and also in the New Testament epistles, it's crucial to understand that Old Testament context. In fact, one of the things I've sometimes recommended to very new believers, of course, I've encouraged them to read the Scriptures themselves, but early on, it can be very helpful simply to take a really good children's story Bible and read through the stories of the Old Testament so that you get the big picture of the story of redemption. It's hard really to understand the New Testament without that context. And as many of you will know from your own studies in theology and in Bible, in Old Testament and New Testament, so often it's not simply a particular verse that's quoted in the New Testament, but the New Testament writers are really calling to mind a whole Old Testament narrative, a whole Old Testament context. And even if you were able to read the verse in the New Testament, you wouldn't really understand what is truly being communicated in the New Testament unless you understood that Old Testament background. The Old Testament is necessary background to the New Testament. Third, the Old Testament gives us a fuller understanding of Christ, of the Messiah. The Old Testament gives us a fuller understanding of Christ, the Messiah. And it does this both with regard to the person of Jesus Christ and with regard to the work of Jesus Christ. For example, think of everything that we learn about the prophetic and priestly and kingly ministry of Jesus Christ from understanding the Old Testament. As far as I've been able to determine, Eusebius of Caesarea was the first to use this kind of framework to talk specifically about the ministry of Christ as prophet, priest, and king. But this has been picked up subsequent to that in the history of Christian theology, particularly in the Reformation. You see it in Calvin, you see it in Luther, you see it in Wesley, in other theologians since then. But it's really a way of making sense of the whole Bible and seeing how the whole Bible fits together. You have these leadership responsibilities in the Old Testament, the prophetic, kingly, and priestly ministries, all of which come to their fulfillment in Jesus Christ, in his person and his work. You look at the stories of prophets, priests, and kings in the Old Testament, you see many inspiring, encouraging things that point you to an even greater ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the greater Solomon. He's the greater Moses. He's the greater Aaron. You also see many failures, morally and otherwise, in the life of the Old Testament prophets, priests, and kings. In fact, if you read through the story of the Old Testament, it seems that when the kings are on the right track, so often there's something wrong with prophetic or priestly ministry, or if the king is really going in the wrong direction, at least God raises up a prophet. But you don't have all of those ministries coming together in their fullness, and you certainly don't have them all coming together in one person until the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a way of understanding how the whole Bible fits together and how the Old Testament is prophetic, typological of the ministry of Jesus Christ. Then, of course, you also have in so many ways the sufferings and the glories of Christ worked out in the Old Testament scriptures. This I take to be one of the main points that Jesus makes in his sermon on the road to Emmaus in Luke chapter 24. So crucial for us in understanding how the whole Bible fits together. You'll remember how those two disciples on Easter afternoon are trying to understand the crucifixion, which they are sure happened, and this resurrection, which people are saying happened, and trying to understand how they fit together. And Jesus says this, O foolish ones, O slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And what is the proof of this saving work of Jesus Christ? It is not simply the events of the last 3 days. It is everything said in the Old Testament scriptures about the sufferings and the glories of the Christ. And so beginning with Moses and all the prophets, Jesus interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And later on in that great chapter, as we come to verses 46 and 47, and the words that Jesus spoke to in his appearance to his disciples in Jerusalem, he says, thus it is written, that is to say, in the scriptures of the Old Testament, that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead. And Jesus goes beyond that, those two events, to their meaning and to their application, that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed to all nations. The whole mission of the church in proclaiming a crucified and risen Savior is presented already in the scriptures of the Old Testament. And so I say, this is the third reason to teach and to preach the Old Testament. The Old Testament gives us a fuller understanding of Christ. And I would say also, and this is the fourth thing, a fresher understanding of Christ. A fresher understanding of Christ. There are ways in which we see the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ in a new way, in a fresh way, by seeing the way that he is foretold in the scriptures of the Old Testament. To me, the passage we were looking at in 1 Samuel 22 is an example of that kind of fresh presentation. Or think of John chapter 12, verse 41, where John looks back to the experience of the prophet Isaiah, perhaps having in mind Isaiah chapter 6, when Isaiah saw the Lord high and lifted up. John says, Isaiah saw his glory, that is the glory of Jesus Christ, and spoke of him. You see the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ in a fresh way in Isaiah that you will not see him anywhere else in Scripture. Let's see the glory of Jesus the way Isaiah saw it. That's the invitation we have as we read and teach and preach Isaiah. Or think of Psalm 118, the cornerstone that becomes marvelous in our eyes. You have to really understand the whole Old Testament background of the temple building and construction and the joy of the people of God in seeing a dwelling place for God built in their very midst. And the way these things, by the testimony of Jesus himself, are applied to his own life and ministry. You see his foundational role, the joy that comes from building your life on that cornerstone. You see it surely in the New Testament, but you see it in a fresh way when you understand that Old Testament context. Number five, and perhaps I should say these are in no particular order of importance or logical structure. Remember, I'm not really trying to make 31 points, just one point. But number five, the Old Testament helps us understand our world today. The Old Testament helps us understand our world today, and I think specifically of what is happening in the purposes of God in the nations of the Middle East. Think of all of the ancient conflicts still persisting in our world today that are rooted in the history of the Old Testament. I dare say if we were to take a survey of those of us who are gathered here this morning, we might have more than one interpretation of how Old Testament prophecy relates to what is happening in the world today or what may happen in the future. These things are mysteries for us. They're hard for us to understand or come to agreement about. But could we at least agree that there are prophecies in the Old Testament and events in the Old Testament that help us understand the conflicts of nations that are at the center of what is happening in the world today? That certainly would be my conviction. Number six, the Old Testament gives us more of the promises of God. The Old Testament gives us more of the promises of God. It won't take you long in ministry, whether you are teaching little children or whether you are working with junior high students, or whether it's your calling to walk with a family through some dark road of suffering, or to minister to a single person who's experiencing the brokenness of life, or perhaps ministry to the elderly with all of the struggles that come with that stage of life, it won't take you long to see how desperately people hunger for the promises of God that nourish hope and bring peace and joy and give an expectation of fulfillment for the future. People need more of the promises of God, not less of the promises of God. And one of the ways to give them more of the promises of God is to teach all of the great promises that God has made in the Old Testament, promises of his steadfast love and covenant faithfulness, promises to live by, promises to depend on, promises to count on. You will need this yourself as you persevere in ministry. It's not just other people that are going to need the promises of God. You're going to need the promises of God, particularly when ministry seems at times perhaps unfruitful. And yet you believe that the seeds planted will reap an eternal harvest. You trust in the promises of God, and you will be nourished by those promises, not just from the New Testament scriptures, but also from the Old. Number seven, the Old Testament shows us a fuller range of human experience, a fuller range of human experience. The Old Testament is full of thousands, I guess, of characters, true-to-life characters, real people who lived their lives before God. And so many of them are characters who have become so memorable to us. And we see in the Old Testament a whole range of human experiences, life as people actually lived it, that are not touched upon in the New Testament. Certainly there's a range of human experience in the New Testament as well. But people were loving and fighting and dreaming and marrying and working and eating and drinking and living and dying long before the coming of Jesus Christ. And so many of those real life experiences help us to understand our own experiences in the world and what word God has to speak to us in those experiences. We see the consequences of actions, the way that they invite God's blessing, or perhaps his judgment. But if all we teach and preach, or if the focus of our teaching and preaching is on the New Testament scriptures, we're dealing with a much narrower bandwidth of human experience than we have if we use the whole scriptures in the way that God intends. Number eight, the Old Testament teaches us more of the law of God. The Old Testament teaches us more of the law of God. And here I think perhaps first of all of the Torah, of the books of Moses, of the Pentateuch, of the specific laws that are given in that part of the Old Testament scriptures, but also the unpacking of the implications of the law and the way that the law is applied both to personal life and to community life in the teaching of the prophets. And this law of God may point us in the direction of obedience and help us to understand how to live. That's one of the God-given, Spirit-intended purposes of the law. But the law also has a purpose of convicting us of sin and leading us into repentance. And for the law to have this effect in the Christian life and this effect in evangelism, it needs to be proclaimed. And really to preach the law in its fullness and understand the law in its fullness, you need the presentation of the law and the application of the law in the scriptures of the Old Testament. As I reflect now on some 20 years of gospel ministry since the time when I was first ordained, I have to say that some of the most fruitful seasons of preaching ministry in terms of people coming to faith in Christ and also growing in the life of Christian discipleship were through the clear proclamation of the law of God. Now, that's in a context where the gospel is also being presented. I want to do that anytime I'm opening the scriptures. But the Spirit uses the law of God to bring the conviction of sin that leads to faith in Jesus Christ and leads to fruitful Christian discipleship. I was interested to hear the testimony of Lon Allison, who directs the Billy Graham Center at Wheaton College. He was recently with Billy Graham. Billy Graham, who incidentally is celebrating his 95th anniversary, 95th birthday this fall. And just coming out, I think it's just out, a book of simple explanation of the gospel way of salvation. And many of us had thought this was the last book that he would collaborate on, but he actually has another book in mind to follow that one. And I think most people would be surprised by the topic that he's thinking about, meditating on, something he thinks is important for the people of God to hear in the world today. And that's the biblical doctrine of hell and the wrath of God. It has to do with the preaching of God's law and the consequences of the judgment of God. And I am sure that the reason Billy Graham is thinking about that kind of proclamation is he knows that is one of the things that the Holy Spirit uses to bring people to faith in Jesus Christ. Let the law of God have that place in your teaching and preaching ministry. Number nine, and here's a very different kind of reason to teach or to preach the Old Testament. The Old Testament exposes us to more biblical poetry. And I'm saying that's a good thing. The Old Testament exposes us to more biblical poetry, which is a delight to the soul. I think, and maybe some Old Testament scholar here can correct me on my numbers, I think I've heard that about 40% of the Old Testament is written in verse form. That's an advantage, not a disadvantage, because poetry touches the mind and the heart in a different way than prose does, in a different way than historical narrative does, in a different way than propositional exposition does. Now, the Bible speaks to the whole person, and so whatever part of us responds to what is poetic, even if that's not a very developed appetite within us, the Bible will speak to that through its poetry. Of course, it's also our experience of life in the church and in the world that different kinds of literature speak to different people in different ways because of their own temperament and how what a blessing it is that the Holy Spirit has revealed so much of God's Scripture in poetic form. Poetry connects us to our experience of living in the world. It contains images of beauty, images that force us to a deeper reflection. We don't grasp it immediately. We have to work to understand the connection that poetry is making. Poetry reaches people who are more reached by poetry than by prose. And the Old Testament, because so much of it is poetry, opens up the amazing resources of poetry for the ministry of teaching and preaching and evangelism and in discipleship in the church. Number 10, the Old Testament seems to be Christ's own method of preaching the gospel to himself. It seems to be Christ's own method of preaching the gospel to himself. I think, for example, of the way that Jesus handled temptation when the devil was coming against him with all of his temptations, the temptation of glory without the cross and all the rest of it. What was the method that Jesus used to resist those temptations? It was going back to the scriptures of the Old Testament. It was reflecting on the teaching of Deuteronomy, of all things. What a mighty weapon for resisting the powers of the evil one, the book of Deuteronomy. Jesus had been preaching to himself and understanding in a deep way that scripture so that it was ready to hand when he needed it to resist the temptations of the devil. Or think of all the quotations we have from the Psalms in the hours when Jesus was betrayed and crucified, the fruit perhaps of a lifetime steeped in that portion of God's word. This is the way that in times of trial, Jesus proclaimed the gospel to himself, not as someone who needed the gospel for himself, but as somebody who had the calling to live out the gospel and carry out the gospel so that it would be good news to us. Surely we are not wiser than Jesus. Number 11, the Old Testament is the apostolic method of preaching the gospel to the world. It's not just Christ's own method of preaching the gospel to himself. It's the apostolic method of preaching the gospel to the world. The apostles, if you look at the sermons in the book of Acts, are always preaching the crucifixion and especially the resurrection. If you've looked at the sermons of Peter and Paul and Stephen and Philip and the rest of them, there is, if anything, a little more emphasis on the resurrection of the Christ than the crucifixion, but they're both proclaimed there, and they are proclaimed there from the scriptures of the Old Testament. I suppose they were preaching the gospel the way that Jesus taught them to preach it. I sometimes wish when I turn to Luke 24 and see this brief reference to Jesus proclaiming to the disciples on the road to Emmaus everything that was said in the scriptures concerning himself. Wouldn't you have loved to have the camcorder for that sermon? But in a way, we at least have the notes, because I think the apostles were preaching the way they learned to preach the gospel from Christ all the way through the New Testament, and they do it with reference, with foundation in the Old Testament texts. Number 12, the Old Testament opens up more than half of the Bible for use in ministry. The Old Testament opens up more than half of the Bible for use in ministry. You perhaps have noticed that comparatively, the New Testament is much shorter than the Old Testament. And a ministry that does not make regular use of all the resources in the Old Testament scriptures, it's a little bit like fighting with one arm tied behind your back. We want both of the, we want the sword of the Spirit from to be wielded from both the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament opens up more than half of the Bible for use in ministry. Number 13, preaching the Old Testament honors the Holy Spirit who breathed out these words. Now, I imagine I'm hardly telling you any new thing in my remarks this morning, but part of what I want to do is just give you reason upon reason to enforce and press upon you the value, the excellent value of the Old Testament for ministry. And here is another reason. Preaching the Old Testament honors the Holy Spirit who first breathed out these words. Now, this is in a way very similar to a point I made earlier when I was quoting from 2 Timothy chapter 3, where it is said that the whole Scripture, all Scripture, is breathed out by God. But here I'm making a slightly different point. I've been saying that preaching from the Old Testament honors the Lord Jesus Christ, who is prophesied and proclaimed in the Old Testament scriptures, but I also want to say that preaching the Old Testament honors the Holy Spirit, because these are words breathed out by the Holy Spirit for use in the Christian life and in ministry. And so in reading these words, meditating on these words, teaching them to others, we are giving honor to the third person of the Holy Spirit. And we are opening up to his influence those who do not know Jesus Christ in a saving way and those who have come to Christ through the Spirit's ministry. The Spirit loves to take the scriptures, including the Old Testament scriptures, and bring them to life in the life of men, women, and children. Number 14, the Old Testament gives us a clearer, fuller picture of our sin. The Old Testament gives us a clearer, fuller picture of our sin. And here I think not only about specific Old Testament scriptures that characterize for us the nature of sin. Would you really understand sin as fully as you do if you had not heard David say, "Against you, you only have I sinned," when it's a very sordid, human-level kind of sin? Or if you had not heard Jeremiah say, "The heart is desperately wicked"? It's not only that, however, specific things that the Old Testament says about sin. It's also the aspects of sin that are more fully displayed in the often sordid history of the Old Testament. Now, you get a kind of anatomy of envy in the story of Ahab and Naboth's vineyard. Or you get a sense of the way that sin wants to deny responsibility in the story of Cain and Abel. You see a working out of sin and the shape that it takes in life as you read these stories from the Old Testament, a clearer picture of sin. Number 15, and again, this is perhaps evident from some of the things I've already said, but the Old Testament gives us more good stories to tell. The Old Testament gives us more good stories to tell. There are many people in the church, starting, frankly, at a pretty early age, who think that they have pretty much heard all of the great stories in the Bible. But for most Christians, there are some really great stories in the Old Testament that they don't remember or perhaps have never really heard or studied before. And what a joy it is to tell people a new story. I think of a missions conference I attended not too many years ago that had a kind of, they wanted to give a variety of missionaries who were back for the conference an opportunity to testify to God's work through their ministry, and they had a sort of readers' theater where maybe a dozen of these missionaries and maybe some members of the Missions Commission were all seated on stools up at the front of the church, and they were all reading from a kind of script, and from time to time, someone would say, "Tell us a story," and then the whole chorus of them would say, "Yes, tell us a story," and then one of the missionaries would relate some narrative of God's work through their own, in their own place of gospel work. But there's something very compelling about somebody saying, "Tell us a story," and when you hear somebody say that, you have an anticipation of the story that will be told, because we love stories. It's part of our human condition. I think just as a very recent example, I was teaching through 2 Kings and came to that very puzzling passage. Maybe it's in 2 Kings chapter 8, where the prophet Elisha is giving a prophecy to Hazael, who's the servant of Ben-Hadad. And the upshot of the prophecy is that Hazael will succeed Ben-Hadad, but Elisha begins to weep over this because he knows that Hazael will be an instrument of judgment and destruction against the people of God. And you have this very poignant story of the prophet just openly weeping over the prophecy of judgment that God has revealed to him. And it was a story not familiar, not very familiar to many of the people in the Sunday school class I was teaching, but very relevant to what we see happening in the world today. And there was a clear call for us to enter into lamentation as we see the way that sin brings the judgment of God. We entered into Elisha's experience in a way that related and applied to what we were seeing in the world in a way we never would have unless we had been in this kind of story with this kind of emotional response. That's just one example of the many wonderful stories to tell from the Old Testament. Number 16, the Old Testament tells us the story of our own people. Our own people, the one people of God. How helpful it is to know the story of your own people. I've found that in ministry in Philadelphia as I've learned the story of the congregation I served for 15 years. The 10th Presbyterian Church are coming back now to Wheaton College, which is a place where I was raised. How helpful it is to read the stories of the presidents who have gone before me and to learn from their mistakes and from their experience of God's faithfulness. I remember when I was in seminary doing a church history paper on the religious and cultural history of Pella, Iowa, which was a settlement where my Dutch forebears came from the Netherlands seeking religious freedom. And again, as I read that story going back more than 100 years, I was able to say, yes, those are my people. Those Dutch Iowa farmers in the cold of winter, talking about predestination. Those are my people. The people that brought the ship docked in the Baltimore Harbor, and the Baltimore Sun reported that it was the cleanest ship of immigrants that had ever touched American shores. That was my grandmother. I mean, you enter into an experience from knowing that history. And for us, that history is the story of the Exodus, for example, or going back to the story of Abraham. It's not just a story about them, it's a story about us, because we are part of the one great people of God, and this is the story of God's work in our lives. Number 17, the Old Testament gives us greater confidence in the truth of the gospel. And I say this particularly because the Old Testament is rooted in history. The Old Testament gives us greater confidence in the truth of the gospel because it is so rooted in history. And over time, the trajectory of biblical studies and biblical archaeology has been to provide greater confirmation of the truthfulness of the Old Testament narratives. I mentioned that briefly just in passing, and I press on. Number 18, the Old Testament presents a fuller revelation of the character of God. The Old Testament presents a fuller revelation of the character of God, and that is because he is the main character in every story. God dominates the narrative of the Old Testament as no character ever dominated a story. Now, of course, the New Testament gives us a complete, well-rounded portrait of the character and being of Almighty God. But at a minimum, we could say there is greater fullness and detail given to that character when we also read the stories and the hymns and the praises and the poems of the Old Testament scriptures. We are living in a time, John Piper said this not too long ago, when people are starving for God. And if they are starving for God, let us feed them God himself from the Old Testament as well as the New Testament. Number 19, the Old Testament gives us something new to learn and teach. The Old Testament gives us something new to learn and teach. And this is implicit in things I've already said. But the Old Testament, I find, is not so familiar as the New Testament. At least some parts of it are not so familiar. And therefore, in teaching and preaching, that gives you the privilege and the joy of sharing with people something that they do not know well or perhaps have never heard before, something new to learn and teach. Number 20, the Old Testament is useful for training in righteousness. It's useful for training in righteousness, and not only that, for correction and for rebuke, all those things that were mentioned in 2 Timothy as we read before. Earlier, I was making the point from that verse that the Old Testament is worth teaching and preaching because it's the very Word of God breathed out by the Holy Spirit. Here I'm making a separate point, and that is that the Old Testament is useful. The Holy Spirit didn't just give this Word. The Holy Spirit gives this Word now for training, correction, rebuke. This is the effect that the Scripture has when it is applied, and I'll be talking hopefully in a helpful way about this tomorrow, different ways of applying the Old Testament scriptures. See if I can talk about some things that will help us be more effective in applying the scriptures. And because the Old Testament scriptures have this effect, it's not just for others that it has this effect. It has this effect on you as you study and teach and preach the Old Testament scriptures. You are trained, you are corrected, you are rebuked. I think, for example, of the simple exhortation in Luke chapter 17, verse 32, drawing on Old Testament narrative. The verse simply says this: remember Lot's wife. Well, what a word of practical application to our times when people are tempted to look at all of the temptations of a fallen world. What volumes that short verse speaks about the temptations of our own time. That's a good verse for you as a servant of God's Word to be meditating on, perhaps corrected by or trained by or rebuked by. Well, I see our time is nearly up. I only got up to 20. I've got 11 more of these, and I didn't even get to them. The Old Testament will stretch you, helping you to grow. Preaching the Old Testament is vindicated by the history of the church. It'll give you a richer appreciation of the grace of God. I think, for example, of a time when I was preaching through Jeremiah. I have to confess that my senior minister, this was in my first year in ministry, wasn't sure it was a great idea to preach all the way through the book of Jeremiah. Although once we got started, he had a lot of enthusiasm for it. But one of the things about Jeremiah is you get long chapter after chapter after chapter of the judgment of God. But how sweet the comforting promises and grace of God come when you finally get to the promises of the new covenant. You understand the grace of God and his mercy for a broken people in a way you never would unless you worked carefully through the whole thing. The Old Testament helps us see the gospel. It gives us a broader perspective on the work of missions. It gives us a deeper understanding of many great doctrines of the Christian faith. It brings people to faith in Christ. I suppose I would think of the Gospels of the New Testament as what the Spirit would particularly use to bring people to faith in Christ, but that wasn't Timothy's experience. Paul said, you know the Scriptures which made you wise unto salvation. Paul was talking about the Old Testament Scriptures. Not long ago, I spoke with a friend who does gospel work in China and was working with a student who set out to read the Bible from beginning to end. My friend thought that perhaps he would be better advised to start with the Gospels and then maybe go back to the Old Testament. But this person really wanted to get the foundational things. It was long before he got to the New Testament. He came back to my friend. He said, I see that there must be a Christ. And it was simply by reading the scriptures of the Old Testament that the Spirit used to bring this man to faith in Christ. Well, there is so much more that could be said, but can we be encouraged this morning in the amazing gift that God has given us in the scriptures of the Old Testament, something useful for evangelism and discipleship, something that you can base a ministry upon, the scriptures of the Old as well as the New Testament. Let's have a closing prayer together. And if you'll come forward for our benediction.